Hello and welcome back to the Front Three Show. We're here again in the palatial suites of the Prince of Rome. It's Filippo, hello.
Good evening, Philip.
Brenton's going to join us in about 10 seconds. He's just setting the video up and coming around now. Plenty to talk about this week, lads, because it's a big week of football. Still ongoing as well. That's why we're on an earlier slot, because someone needs to watch his beloved Arsenal later on this evening.
Fair enough.
Which is totally fair enough. Lots happened in the Champions League this week. Lots happened at the weekend.
Understatement, yeah.
Manchester United beat Liverpool, thoroughly deserved it, probably the weekend, and then went out on Tuesday night, and that was random. We'll talk about that in a minute. There was also then last night Chelsea versus Lionel Messi.
That's what it was, yeah.
And the two games seem to, spark a bit of a debate again, which league's the best or what league you prefer. I'm going to talk about that as well tonight. But we should probably get stuck straight into Manchester United and Jose Mourinho and what happened. Do you want to talk about Saturday's game quickly first? Oh, I'm happy enough, I put my hands up. We got beat by Manchester United, fair enough. Or do you want to, it's up to you.
I suppose, in terms of Saturday's game, just quickly, Manchester United were far sharper out of the blocks and Liverpool just couldn't stay with them for that first half. And Liverpool actually got back into the game in the second half. Had a few chances, a few refereeing calls just didn't go their way and they should have done. Manchester United had actually done enough in the first half, and that's what got them the victory.
They deserved it. Rashford was outstanding on Saturday for 25 minutes. He poor trying to analyze Arnold, like he tore him to pieces.
Yeah, and he got a bit of time afterwards, didn't he? But I called it, like, just
you did.
Throw
you
that
did.
Out there.
You were very happy with that. You did.
I thought Mourinho would do something, and he did. I think he seemed to target Lovren in the year against Lukaku.
He targeted that channel, didn't he? Lovren and Trent and then
Chan,
that sort of triangle.
And it nearly got to a stage where they were stopping Van Dijk from coming in on Lukaku, and he peeled right off nearly onto Alexander-Arnold, like between Alexander-Arnold and Lovren.
Mm-hmm.
And he won a few headers before, you know, the one through to Rashford, and then he beat Lovren again in the air for the second goal. I thought Lukaku was actually very good on Saturday, I didn't see the game, but from all reports he was actually alright against Sevilla, who's one of United's better players.
Mm-hmm.
Don't know if you agree with that or not.
He missed a massive chance before he got the goal, which would have maybe given them a chance to come back into the match. I think if Manchester United had scored that chance that he missed, they might have got three goals. Like, I know it's hypothetical, but I mean, it was a big, big chance in a big game when you need the goal. And he missed it, you know.
What did you think of Mourinho's team sheet to start off with on Tuesday night? What did you...
Look, everyone's going to point to the fact that Pogba just didn't make it. Fellaini starts. You know,
Lamata on the bench.
Realistically, are we saying that Marouane Fellaini is a better player than Pogba? No. Does Jose Mourinho trust Fellaini better more than Pogba? Yes. And that's what it came down to, I think, for the selection. But did it benefit Manchester United Football Club? His grandstanding? That's Mourinho's grandstanding? Certainly not, because I think had Pogba been on the pitch, they would have been more likely to have been on the better side of the result. I know it's easy saying, again, hypothetical, but he offers more than Fellaini.
I think actually Wan-Mata is the player that I'd have had over both of them that would have made a bigger impact. Just before you go on, Brent, like Mourinho... On Saturday, after the result against Liverpool, said this isn't our big game. Our big game is Sevilla. Our big games are Sevilla and then Brighton, which to a point I can 100% agree with, because it's the same sort of thing for Liverpool at the minute. We're in the Champions League and we can't catch City, so you're playing for top four. And
you know what he means.
Yeah. But then, to then go out and have his team be so lackadaisical, and to use a term that isn't very technical, not arsed at all. They didn't seem bothered. It's just not that the ball. It didn't seem like they're in themselves. They could go out here and score a goal. It was really, really weird.
But it wasn't even. Now, like as I haven't seen the whole game. I've only seen goals. But the attitude. Not only talk about the players, but Mourinho's attitude and his tactics. How can they be so good against Liverpool and so, I thought they were on point against Liverpool, and then to go so wrong against Sevilla, so soon after, and go with that negative attitude from the start of how many other games this season has he played Matic and Fellaini? How defensive is that? And why switch Marcus Rashford from the left when he's played so well against Liverpool on the left?
That's the major question.
I was baffled.
Why not play a one man who in the last couple of games has been outstanding?
He would start on every team sheet for me.
And then I suppose it leads us into his post-match press conference. Manchester United at this stage have been beaten. They're out of the Champions League. And he has the tenacity to sit there and say, well, I've been here before. I've actually been the man who knocked Manchester United out with Porto and Real Madrid. But Jose, Manchester United are now the football club paying your wages.
And he also just on
that.
You
didn't even realise that.
He said as well, after he beat United with Porto, Alex Ferguson wouldn't shake his hand. Fergie was annoyed at the way he reacted and he ran in the tunnel. And Fergie, it's probably good for Josie that Fergie didn't shake his hand because he probably would have biffed him. But he didn't shake his hand, he was annoyed and he walked off. And Josie was, and I don't know if you can remember him, but he was so cocky and all, like he didn't really read the Chelsea. And he was all like, you know, I would be annoyed too if I was Alex Ferguson when I've just been beaten by a team with a tenth of my budget and I've come up here and my team with all these superstars hasn't played for me. And it's just exactly happened to you. It's a whole circle for him.
Karma.
Oh, bang. But it's really strange.
This is life.
This is life. It's really strange. Like, it was a really... I have a friend at work, hello, Aaron, who's a diehard United fan. And he said to me on Wednesday, first of all, he said, trust me to take Monday and Tuesday off after United beat you and I can't slag you. And then when I come back into work, United have lost. And then he says, another thing, Phil, me and my dad are just heartbroken watching this now. I have been all season. And he says, even though we did beat you on Saturday, it doesn't mean anything. And we were like, the football's puke.
Well, that is the issue. Beating Liverpool, yes, they're a rival and all the rest of it. But in...
What matter at the end of the season?
Long standing. What does it matter? Not that they won the league. Second place isn't a trophy. They're going to get top four anyway. So I'm sure if you ask any United fan, which would you prefer, to beat Liverpool or go through the next round of the Champions League?
Yeah.
You know the answer. Like.
Yeah, look, in the Manchester United team this season, it appears that there's a hole that requires cement or blocks to fill, and at this stage, it's certainly matchsticks that are being used.
Do you think Manchester United and Jose were guilty of not giving Sevilla enough respect?
Well, look, the warning was there. Look, Sevilla were by far the more superior team in the first leg, and the amount of chances that they missed was, I thought they were going to rue that, you know, when they came to Old Trafford. They were by far the better team. So that was their eye-opener. They'd been given their warning and they still couldn't react to it. It also leads to the question mark, is this Manchester United team not capable of putting on two top quality performances in a matter of days?
That's a good point. But also, just to go back to your point about did they not give them enough respect, I would nearly argue that they give them too much with the...
not going after them in the first leg.
And the second leg. You know, you're at home in front of 70,000 people in front of Old Trafford who are expecting a certain type of play and spoke before, but what is the United type of play? What is the United way? But that certainly wasn't what we saw on Tuesday night. You know, by playing those two centre midfielders, we go back to it again. Like, how is that going to produce this, you know, attacking style of play that you're not going to get under Mourinho? But to go through in the next round of the competition, you would expect that they're going to go out at home in the first half and win the game. And then you bring on Fellaini maybe 20 minutes to go, and you take off Rashford and bring on somebody more defensive. But starting with that team didn't add up.
And Bryn, you know, what I would have to ask Mourinho is, you know, this is not a team in Sevilla that, you know, it's not a team that's top of their game in La Liga. Vincenzo Montella has come in there and he has had a very, I suppose, sticky start,
it's an average start.
It's been, you know,
yeah, plateau, yeah, yes. It's been level.
It's been, you know, but they've gone to Old Trafford, they've won, you know. I suppose Manchester United fans, the Fergie blueprint that they've been used to, the style of football that they've been used to, that's long been placed for this team. And the longer that they give Jose Mourinho the time as manager of this club, the further and further they're drifting away from returning to that blueprint. So ultimately, the key figures at Manchester United, the directors, they need to ask themselves a serious question.
Just on Sevilla as well, I actually think Sevilla played a blinder.
They did, they were superb.
I was at the Anfield game in the group stage when they played us, and they were so dangerous, and they just, like, in the start equalising goal to make it 2-2, they just sucker punched us just like they did against United. They waited and they waited and they broke so quickly and so sharply. And the longer that game went on Tuesday night, you sort of could sense it coming out of the TV. You know, you talk about that sometimes, that Sevilla going to be the ones that are going to score here, like United, or something not right, they don't look...
United weren't proactive, were they?
No, it was really weird. United fans, if you're watching live now, or if you're watching later on YouTube or whatever, let us know, like, what's the United way that a lot of your fans talk about and that Josie's not doing? What is it? Because I don't know it. Like, I can think about maybe bomb down the wings, fireball into the box. That sounds like puke to some people, but that's what's so successful United in times. And
yeah, 4-4-2, like, wide wingers, quick wingers. And
attack. And United used to, like, under Fergie, we've said it before, if they were getting beat 1-0 or drawing 1-1, and it was a Saturday afternoon, you're watching Sky Sports, or you're watching CFAX Flytex, because you knew what was coming. Like,
yeah.
You don't see that coming.
2 United goals in the last 3 months.
Yeah, you knew what was coming.
That was the belief that he had instilled in Sir Alex Ferguson. Now, you know, I ultimately, as an Arsenal fan, didn't have the greatest amount of time for him. But when you look back, Manchester United fans didn't realise that they were going through a utopia in their history, and it doesn't look like they're going to return to it for any time soon.
You mentioned belief there. Just as we finish off about Manchester United, here, someone that looks like he doesn't seem to have much belief or something is lacking is Alexis Sanchez. It signed for massive amounts of money, obviously from your old team Arsenal, not your, his old team Arsenal, your team Arsenal.
Massive wages.
What do you think's going on? Like, what's...
It's kind of hard to say, isn't it? We've said a couple of times that he looks like he's been Space Jam.
Yeah.
Which is really, like, it sounds stupid, but it really makes sense when you see him play. You have a fact about how many times he's given the ball away.
Since he's joined Manchester United, he's given the ball away 247 times. And the next person down, Matt's Ashley Young, who's a fullback, who's given away 143 times. So it's still almost like it was over 100 more, like, so it's a bit daft. Like, he's only been there from January.
It is, and...
Is this from the start of the season?
This is from when he's joined United.
Oh, right, okay.
So, there is the argument, and I did say this to you, that he's an attacking player, and attacking players are going to try things, Messi gives the ball away quite a bit.
But Kevin Bruyne has given it away most in the league.
Yeah, do you know what I mean? That is the point. But then, counter that as well, when you're watching a game and you notice he's giving the ball away loads, like, you don't notice that about De Bruyne, or you don't notice about Messi. Messi probably gave the ball away quite a bit against Chelsea last night, but he also scored 2 goals and set up the other one and was unbelievable.
I suppose, you know,
but Sanchez's not doing that on the other side.
He's not following, he's not tracking the runners, he's making mistakes, and those mistakes are being compounded by more mistakes. You know, as a referee, you know, we joke when I'm talking to colleagues, and that when you make a mistake, you know you've made a mistake, you must get the next 3 decisions 100% correct. And Sanchez, even if he has to do those next 3 things a lot simpler, do it. You know?
Build it back up again.
Exactly.
You've watched him more than us, like, with a lot closer. What was he like? His last year at Arsenal, they look like he looks to me like he's mentally burnt out. He just looks like, I don't know.
With commitments to club and Chile, of course, you know, there's been a lot of pressure on Alexis Sanchez to perform, and he was very frustrating at the start of the season. Having said that, you know, he won games for us as well, but he's not a player, you know, like you talk about the wingers that used to play under Sir Alex Ferguson. He's not that type of player. He's going to drift for a large part of the game. He's actually going to do very little. But what he does, and what he did on the many times for Arsenal, was when he did have the ball, he was clinical with it. And he hasn't done that part with Manchester United. The interesting thing here is that the Arsenal players were delighted to see the back of him. I was reading some reports this week.
That's come out now, hasn't it?
Always come in. People, you know, it's unbelievable when you watch a game. You know, I've been over a number of Arsenal games that he's played in. And it's unbelievable you know, when you watch a game on TV and you see, and they're saying, there's Sanchez tracking again. But ultimately, he was coming out in terms of distance covered near the bottom every game. You know? So he did it to play up to the cameras. If you went and watched the game and sat back and said, what's Sanchez actually doing for the majority of the time? It's not as much as the other players. And he's been found out.
I think it was the game, was it Bayern Munich that he stomped his feet and he was going around? And then I think afterwards, a lot of Arsenal fans supposedly, or our Arsenal players have let him know, like, you're just playing off the camera, and they've clicked, and then it's, I think that's what created a bit of a bad atmosphere with him, and it is good. Interesting that
it was good to, it was good to get rid of him in the sense that he no longer wanted to be there. And, you know, I'm very grateful for the service that he did give for the majority of the time he was there, because I don't want people saying, oh, he's only saying that because he's gone to Manchester United. But no, you know, he has a lot to prove. Arsene Wenger took a chance on him. He had a lot of questions to answer. He didn't have a great time at Barcelona. Wenger took the chance on him. Arguably had his best period of his career at Arsenal. Yes?
Club career, yes.
And, you know, he's gone to Manchester United again. The questions are starting to be asked. I hope he turns it around. He moves to his next club.
Manchester United fans or the football fans, let us know what you think of Alexis Sanchez. I think it is mental fatigue. I think an awful lot of people will say to us, or say to him, about footballers, and I hate this, but they earn so much money. So like, well, how can they have the excuse of being fatigued? But you can physically maybe, yeah, but like, your brain's gonna be busted.
You
know, he does need a rest. You can't train it to just not be with pressure. You can train it to cope sometimes pressure, but there are gonna be pressures playing from that many people. He has a whole country on his back. Like Alexis Sanchez is like the George Best of Chile, on his back. So it's just,
and I suppose too, you know, the average career for a footballer is what, about 18 years?
A good one.
The average career for a normal profession is about 43 years, so they're squeezing arguably 43 years of work into 18, and the pressure that comes along.
100,000 people
exactly.
Every week.
It's very difficult, you know.
Yeah, and we had a couple of comments as well on a post from the other day and from today. John Monahan said that he reckons that next season Alexis Sanchez will be much better, and he actually reckons that it's the other United players that are not up to speed with him. Which is an interesting comment. I wouldn't be on that sort of level. I don't think so.
It's an interesting comment. I think that comment might be more out of hope than anything else.
Yeah.
As a United fan, I'm sure, like all fans are the same, you want your big signings. If your club has forked out that much money, you want them to do so well. You know, I was desperate for Torres to do well when he came to Chelsea, because it was 50 million. It was a big deal. It was January transfer window, all the rest of it. And it just never happened. He did score against Barcelona in the semi-final of the Champions League. Was sort of made up for it. But, you know, I think that comment might be more, I don't hope that he'll do it than any evidence he's given so far at United. Who knows? If Mourinho's not there next season, you know, somebody who compliments Sanchez could come in and make him the main man, and the whole thing's turned around. But I think the other players, that the comment about the other players not up to speed with him, they're maybe not up to speed with him, but they're used to Mourinho now, and Sanchez might not be used to his way, and they've learned.
That's what Mikey Phillips said. He commented, thank you for your comments, lads. He said that he doesn't fit in at United, Alexis Sanchez.
Look, serious questions to be asked. When this transfer was taking place, Mino Raiola, the agent obviously of Henrik Mkhitaryan, said that the deal was really centred on Henrik Mkhitaryan. He was the big player. People laughed. But Henrik Mkhitaryan has been more productive for Arsenal, without question, than Sanchez has been for Manchester United. So, yet again, Raiola has been proved right.
Before we go on and talk about who thinks which is the best league and different things, we should probably talk about Lionel Messi, Brenton.
It is
fair enough. Like, if Liverpool get him on tomorrow and he does what he does, it's fair enough. What did you make of last night?
It was all about Lionel Messi.
It was one of his nights.
Yeah.
People could say, do you remember Messi against Chelsea?
Yeah. And as I was saying to you lads earlier, we're not really used to that as Chelsea fans, because we've played Barcelona countless times in the last sort of 10 years in the Champions League, and Messi hasn't really let it up. But I think he made up for it kind of over the last two legs.
Nobody got Jerome Boateng though, at least.
Yeah, that's true.
That's a bonus.
You could argue Thibaut Courtois kind of did a wee bit, but
stood at the top hand, didn't he?
Yeah. But it was one of his nights. You know, it was one of the, you know, the games I tuned into where my team was involved and watched the build up, and you know, obviously the talk about Messi and the talk about Eden Hazard step up, which is another issue, and he really didn't. And to build Messi up, and he performed like he did. He just took the end of Chelsea by himself.
He seems to be more
set the tone early.
He seems to be more confident. Like, it's, and that's gonna sound mad, but let me explain myself. He seems to absolutely love now that he is like the Camp Nou. He always was like, he has been for years, but he always sort of seemed a bit timid or something. But now he seems to have a bit of like a, not a nasty streak in him, but a bit of a like, yeah, look at me. Like, even when he scored and he went over to the Barcelona fans like this here, he did it against PSG last year, but it wasn't even a score, it was Neymar, and he stood like this. He seems to just revel in it, which is quite scary, because if he decides now, all of a sudden at 31 almost, actually I am the man, then I think...
How many more years?
Yeah. What were you going to say, Jake?
Well, just a few things. Firstly, Courtois was poor.
Yeah.
Secondly, Hazard was haphazard. In terms of his approach, you know, we talked earlier about no Manchester United player taking the game by the scruff of the neck. That's exactly what Messi did. How did Hazard respond? He was the man Chelsea were looking towards. There was no response. It was very disappointing. All of Chelsea's good play, you would say, did not come through him.
No, it came through Willian.
Yeah,
and Kante.
And Kante won a lot of ball back. I think Kante passed the ball to Willian the most times last night, which was winning the ball and giving it straight to Willian. Hazard didn't seem to get enough of the ball, or he didn't seem to really want a lot of it. He didn't do anything special, as in pick up the ball and go past two or three players.
I think when they would just have gone 1-0 down, and then that was the last time.
And that is obviously when he looks his most dangerous, when he does that. And if that was his audition for going to La Liga last night, it wasn't a good one.
Look,
because you can be sure Real Madrid watching that game thinking, this is against our biggest rivals, let's see what he can do. And over the two legs, they'll
probably decide to go for Kante now.
Look, he probably hoped, if that was an addition, he probably hoped that the curtain wasn't drawn. Because you wouldn't be proud of that, you know. Another thing just to point out, Luis Suarez, where was he? I know he slipped the ball to Messi on two occasions for his goals, but like, he missed a sitter. The man who really dictated the play at Liverpool, that's the player that they wanted. He's sort of happy to have this more sedentary role, which is surprising. You know?
Yeah, also as well,
I don't think you have a choice with Messi.
No.
Dembele's goal is all about the pass from Messi, obviously.
Nah, yeah.
But if you watch it again, Suarez's clever run drags, is it Rudiger? He drags him away from the play as well. And then there's five Chelsea players are stuck in no man's land because Messi has decided that he can see Dembele even though nobody else can see him. Like, we were watching the TV and we didn't even notice Dembele.
Yeah, he was out of the picture.
Like, so he fires the ball across to him. And then Dembele takes about, it must be about a good 3 hours before he hits it. And then it's daylight.
That's
the time
just the Liverpool fan.
It's daylight by the time he thumps it. Like, and it's just time stopping. He's firing in the top corner, but... No, I get your point. Suarez, he's certainly not the Liverpool Suarez this year anyway.
No, and I would also say that Dembele too, I know he's very young, he only really had one main season at Dortmund.
And he was Ren before that.
You know, he's a lot to answer as well. Good point here from John Taggart, actually, in terms of Messi being the saviour for what is quite an average team. This is Ernesto Valverde's tactic. He is a master at getting the best out of his team, at utilising the best players that he has. This Barcelona team, they won 3-0 last night, but that is not their style. They're much more functional than they have been previously. And Valverde, you do not underestimate him. He has been a very smart choice from the board at Barcelona because they knew this was an aging team in some regards. There's a lot of rebuilding to be done. We need to put Messi to the fore so that he will win us the games. And Ernesto Valverde has done that absolutely beautifully. He deserves
the way he's managed Iniesta has been brilliant.
Are you tapping Ernesto Valverde up there on live the sports level just for Arsenal? Because it sounded very much like you were.
We don't have a Messi.
I understand John's point, and I said this to you on the way over. This Barcelona team aren't the team of Pep's first team or his second team or Luis Enrique's team that won it. But next year I think that they'll push Luis Suarez on. Mm. They could possibly, it could be Griezmann coming in. They'll have Coutinho, Iniesta, I know will probably be being phased out. Busquets, Rakitic, they'll have these lads. They're sure to probably sign another absolutely flying fullback from somewhere. I think Semedo actually has been playing quite well for them. But yeah, it's not, you wouldn't, you're not as scared of this Barcelona team as you were of other teams. You're scared of Messi.
Yeah, and when he decides to do it, that's the end of it.
But this Barcelona team, I would say, is much better defensively. This Barcelona team is much more difficult to
just
break down.
To say, I thought Titi was very good last night.
Very good. And you know who else that has had a bit of a resurrection in terms of his career at Barcelona under Valverde is Thomas Vermaelen. Now, I know he didn't get into the game, into the team last night.
But
he's getting
played
more games. And mm-hmm. next season, he could perhaps take over from Pique. Who knows?
They could go to a three.
You know, they could go to a three. Vermaelen without injuries is a quality player, you know. Again, Arsenal, stick up for your own stable, you know.
Aaron Donnelly and Marty Polly, thank you for your comments, and John too. Aaron says, I blame the manager's tactics, not the players. He's talking about Manchester United. United under Jose are a functional team, solid defence, and players have to put in a shift, but there's no freedom going forward to get the likes of Sanchez, Martial didn't come on, it's another whack mad one, Rashford to go on. Take players on, like Fergie encouraged, 100%.
Mm.
It's no surprise Lingard has come to form. He fits the bill, hard working, just what Jose want, with no flair. I think that's a wee tiny bit harsh on Lingard. I was Lingard's biggest critic at the start of the season. He's proved me wrong. He's scored 14 goals or something this year since.
Some really good goals.
He has scored some goals in some big games. But I take the rest of Aaron's point on fully. It all lies at the foot of Jose Mourinho. This United team is just not fulfilling what they should be with the talent that they have.
And the money they've spent.
The money they've spent. And I think it could get a little bit worse for them because I think they'll lose David De Gea in the summer. And I don't know who they're replacing him with. And like he has kept them. He has saved the most shots this year. And he's faced the most shots, I think, in the top six. Certainly,
yeah, which shows that the effectiveness there. Like we thought Matthews would be a major signing for him. He's done quite well on occasion. But even he looks the shadow of a player he was at Chelsea, you know.
Marty Polly also says, hello Marty, Suarez takes a secondary role. What player plays or Messi doesn't? It's not through choice, Messi's unreal.
But look, I suppose Marty, they're a very good point.
My
suggestion might be lost a little bit in translation there. Of course, Messi is superior to other players. But look, how did Sanchez react to being the second fiddle at Barcelona? He had to get a move. Some players do not take this well.
Right.
Suarez has taken it in his
You were saying that Suarez gets stuck in and he's accepted it.
Yes.
Yeah.
Iniesta for years, as you said, like, you know, Iniesta would have walked into any other team
That's
in
right.
Europe and been the main man of
He's
time.
Been the best midfielder in the world in the last 10 years,
yeah.
In my opinion.
And, like, you talk about Messi and inevitably, you're always going to.
Mm-hmm.
But like
and those boys accept that, like, you know,
that's just the price of playing with the greatest player of the generation, you know.
Let's just chat about Ray Wilkins started a whole thing because he went in February and said that Manchester United, like Sevilla, should almost just lie down and let United go on through because they're not fit enough, basically, blah blah blah, to play against Manchester United. And Manchester United find this easy, and of course, it drummed up the debate again that what is the best league and which league do you prefer and blah blah blah. What do you think of that comment for a start, both of you? Like, that debate's tedious now, in my opinion.
I suppose it's all relative, you know.
Exactly.
You're talking about, you know, what team you're talking about, at what stage of the season, in what competition, with what players. It's a good debate, only because everyone has their own opinion on it.
Yeah.
There's no right or wrong answer.
Yeah.
But I suppose from my personal point of view, I said it before, like, you know, I'm maybe a bit ignorant to La Liga, you know. Certainly 5 years ago, I only would have watched El Clasico, hands down. Definitely would have only watched El Clasico unless Chelsea were playing a Spanish team in the Champions League.
Or Europa League final.
Or Europa League final, yes. But watched bits and pieces of La Liga in the last couple of years, and I think the football is better, but personally I don't find it as entertaining. Entertaining is a real key word for me. It's what you want out of watching a football match, and then it comes down to personal opinion. If you want, you know, total football passing out from the back and build your way up to the perfect goal, you're asking me about a perfect goal, but I don't, when it comes to Chelsea, I don't care how they score goals, you know what I mean? But in games like, you know, relegation teams, let's call them, in the Premier League, it's the, you know, you don't know what way that's going to end. It's the unpredictability of it I like. And the fact that, you know, Stoke can beat United, you know, at Old Trafford.
Mm. West Brom can beat Liverpool in the FA Cup.
Do you know what I mean?
A strong Liverpool side as well, like it wasn't a weak side.
It's that sort of thing I like about the Premier League, but that's a personal opinion.
What about you, Jake?
The last 10 winners of the Champions League, 6 of them have been Spanish teams, 2 of them have been English teams. That's your answer.
So you think that La Liga is the best league?
I think in terms of prep, look, what's the best club competition? The Champions League.
Uh-huh.
Look, you, that's the competition you want to be in. Which league prepares you best to win that? La Liga.
And there's only been 2 Spanish winners of the European Cup.
Barcelona and Real, obviously.
Yeah, there's been, let me go through them because I've tried to learn this. Aston Villa, Nottingham Forest, Liverpool, Chelsea, Manchester United. I didn't leave anyone out there, shouldn't I? It's been 5.
I'm sure somebody let you know.
And there has been 5. Liverpool won 5, United,
Chelsea,
yeah, Nottingham Forest, Chelsea and Aston Villa. Do you know? So there's been more winners, but I totally get your point. I was going to say, which I thought you would have had because you were the stat man, was they played each other 26 times. I think it's from 2008 or 2009 or something.
What is this now?
English teams against Spanish teams in Europe. They played each other 26 times and Spanish teams have won 22 of them.
Look, I'm telling you now, the quality of the football now, people will say, okay, there's those top teams that dominate the picture in Spain. But you watch any of the other, it depends, the war of attrition, if you want that, then you'll watch Stoke against West Brom, you know? I want more than that from football because I believe it is an entertainment business. In playing that moreness of football, you're more prepared to win.
Okay? Would you prefer to watch La Liga? Would you prefer to watch Real Betis against, the table here, so Real Betis are 8, and maybe my team La Liga, up with Betis. Real Betis against Villarreal and Leicester, I can't pick Arsenal, but Leicester against Burnley or Real Betis against Valencia, say?
Real Betis against Valencia.
See, I would watch the other one, 100%.
That's interesting. Like, yeah. I don't think there's any right or wrong to say which league's better. And by the way, all the other fans, you're obviously my team in second.
You know, what will English teams inevitably do when they come against these Spanish teams? They'll sit with a packed defence, yes?
Yeah.
The Spanish teams are used to playing intricate football that will get them through those packed defences. Of course, Di Matteo didn't go like that for Di Matteo, but largely, 22 out of 26 ties won by the Spaniards. Look, I think that's your answer.
I'm just playing devil's advocate. I don't know if it's really my opinion or not, but people will say to you, is that because La Liga isn't as competitive for those bigger teams? You know, are the likes of, you know, John said,
Premier League most competitive, apart from Derby about 10 years ago, we finished season
Robbie
17
Savage's
points.
Team.
Always very tight at the bottom. Look at Serie A, Benevento at the bottom wouldn't beat Millwall. Not now they wouldn't, because there's probably no confidence. But I think on a match, I think Benevento and Millwall would be interesting. If you were to put them down together, I don't think Millwall would win that myself, but and that might be just, is John a Crystal Palace fan?
Yes.
Good choice of Millwall there, because and good choice of verb, wouldn't beat Millwall. You didn't say in a football match, because I certainly wouldn't beat them out of it either. Do you know what Millwall are like?
Yeah, we would love Millwall, but we're not getting in trouble with Millwall fans if we ever end up in London.
But what, that's what I'm saying, what you know, are Swansea more likely to beat
Girona?
No, are Swansea more likely to beat, say, Liverpool than Girona are to beat, you know, Barcelona?
Did who?
Liverpool.
Right.
So his question was, is there more chance of Swansea beating Liverpool?
Mm-hmm.
Which they did, but take it out of it. Or the likes of Girona beating,
Atletico.
It all depends on the game.
Okay, because Eibar are 9th. And they beat Sevilla 5-1 about 2 weeks ago.
But we talk about the big three, like.
Yeah.
They must very rarely get beat by.
Do you think Spain's big three would be England's big three at the minute? Like England's top three, don't say big, like the top three. Spurs, United, and City against Barcelona, Atletico Madrid, and Real Madrid.
I think it'll be very, very tight.
That'll be close, I think. You don't think it'll be close?
Like when you match them up.
Yeah, you could just match them up.
I think the point there in terms of the competitive nature of the Premier League is what people love. In terms of the quality of the teams, I think United and Spurs would both lose. Manchester City would be the only team that have a chance.
I'd like to see Spurs against Atletico Madrid.
Yeah.
I think Real Madrid and Manchester United Real Madrid against Spurs, but if you mixed it and said Real Madrid against Manchester United, it would be an interesting game as well. And Barcelona and Man City's 1-1 to see in the Champions League, so...
It'll be a good Champions League final.
Yeah, it's interesting. I think it's an interesting... I said tedious. It's tedious the way that people seem to be so defensive over what league's better and so annoyed. And comments like what Ray Wilkins made just doesn't help anyone because it's just daft to even say that, but...
Yeah. Well, it'll be interesting to see what everybody else thinks.
Yeah, let us know what you think. What league do you think is the best? It might even be La Liga. Like, I personally think...
Or a different one.
1990 yeah. Serie A is the best we've ever had it in football. Like, I loved that time and... It was the best we ever had. Like, I don't know, you two didn't watch much of it because you're only Bambinos, but it was really, really good, 1990s Serie A.
The best league is always the league in which there's a game on when you want to watch football.
That's nice.
Which is all the time.
Yeah. So, thanks for joining this week. Next Thursday, actually, I don't know if I haven't told the lads, we mightn't be here, because Northern Ireland are playing Spain, under-21s, and I want to go to it, and I'd like us to go to it, so I'm telling you it's live on TV. Because there's a couple of players, like Carlos Soler from Valencia is playing, Fabian from Betis is playing, there's a couple of Real Madrid players around it, like Ceballos and stuff like that there, so I'd like us to go and do that. So we will be there next week, so we might be on a different night next week. But thanks for joining, thanks for watching live, thank you to the two lads for coming in, thank you Brendan, thank you Jake, thanks to everyone that commented, and keep checking us out on YouTube at The Sports Babble. We now have our own page, our own URL, it's just youtube.com/The Sports Babble. On Facebook here and on Twitter. We'll see you on again next week. Good luck.